Good afternoon. Welcome to the Wednesday, July 18th session of the Cape Cod Regional Government Assembly of Delegates. Before I begin the meeting, I'd like to introduce a couple of people. We have Greg Hildebrandt, who'll be doing our recording. It's Greg over there in the corner. You can't see him because the camera's pointed away from him. And we have Linda Wesson, who's going to be taking our minutes and stuff. So, welcome aboard. Also, this meeting will be recorded by others besides Greg. Okay, so we will now begin with the moment of silence, the call meeting order, beginning the moment of silence to honor our troops who have died in service to our country and all those serving our country in our forces. Thank you, and we'll now stand for the Pledge of Allegiance. Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of
the United States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
The clerk will call the roll.
Richard Anderson?
Here.
Cheryl Andrews?
Here.
Ronald Bergstrom?
Here.
Leo Kukunis?
Here.
Christopher Kanega? James Killian?
Here.
Marcia King?
Here.
Teresa Martin?
Here.
Deborah McCutcheon?
Here.
Spiro Mitrokostas?
Here.
John Ullman? Paul Pilcher?
Here.
Patrick Princey?
Here.
Anthony Scalise? Julia Taylor?
Here.
Mr. Speaker, we have a quorum present with 86.14% of the delegates present, 13.86% absent.
Okay, thank you. Now that he's made it official that he's actually here, I respond. I'd like to introduce to those who don't know Patrick Princey, who is the new delegate from Barnstable, appointed recently by the town council, and he'll be with us for the remainder of the term. Well-known figure here in the club. I'm sure he'll sit in ably for his predecessor, Tom. I'll now need a motion to approve the calendar of business.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? You should have received a copy of the Journal of June 20, 2012. As many additions or corrections to the Journal? Hearing none?
Move approval of the Journal of June 20th as presented.
Second.
Okay. We move to second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. We now move to communications from the Board of Regional Commissioners. I see two of the commissioners here. So if someone like to... step up to the mic.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Good evening, or morning, afternoon, whatever. It's been a long day. Very happy and pleased to see Patrick Princey here. Congratulations, Patrick. That was a very good appointment on the part of the Barnstable Town Council, and I think we're all pleased to be able to work with you, at least for the remainder of the year. A few things I wanted to mention today. The county is represented on what's called M3 Cubed. That's an advisory group to the commanders at the Mass Military Reservation. And the group meets anywhere from 4 to 5 times a year. And they met last week, and the Department of Defense and through the Congress have determined that there shall be another, what they call a JLUS, which is a joint land use strategic planning process for the base. 5 years ago, they had a JLUS, and this year they have another. And the Cape Cod Commission has been contracted to oversee and do the majority of the planning work associated with the JLUS. And Sharon Rooney will be the, who is our chief technical, chief planner, but the Cape Cod Commission is the lead person on this project. And it will be a very interesting project. The M3Q committee has been established as the policy committee by the MMR commanders, who actually will be providing the input and the review and the recommendations during the progress of the plan and when the plan is completed. The base has taken on some activities that are going to be very helpful to the citizens of the town surrounding the base. They are improving the sandwich gate, which is, any of you that use the sandwich gate know that it's very close to the neighborhood on Snake Pond Road, and they're moving it closer to the base so it won't interfere so much with the movement of families and the people who live there in and out and down the street. They're also going to be making changes to the Falmouth Gate so that people from Mashpee and Falmouth who need to enter the base for any reason will have better access into the Falmouth Gate than what is there right now. The Coast Guard continues to enhance its search and rescue operations on the base. They are acquiring new, improved planes that they use now for search and rescue, and they just almost completed the construction of a new hangar that is required to house this aircraft, and that dedication of that hangar was held on yesterday. So that's good. The base continues to be a major employer on the Upper Cape, contributes a great deal to the economic viability of the towns that surround it, both in payroll and services. So, and those of us who represent our communities, there are those who represent the towns on the base as well as the county has a representative as well. The other, one of the other items I wanted to mention is 911 dispatch. We had a report today from Sean O'Brien that is moving along, and the pace has picked up because there is more interest now on the Cape. We always knew that most of the fire chiefs really understood and appreciated this whole 911 process, and now apparently there are more police chiefs who are also looking at it and recognizing that there is great value in regionalizing the services of 911 dispatch. There were a group of them that had a tour of some of these facilities in other counties, one in New York State, one in Maine, and I can't remember where the other one was. So they had some site visits they were able to see from the hands-on the real value of the of a regional service for dispatch. How that will end up, where it will be, has not yet been determined, but it is moving along on a much better path. And one of the very positive parts about the dispatch too was the technology that when a call comes in, let's say it's a fire, immediately visible on the screen at the dispatch is the location itself, what's on it. If it's a home, you see the house. It shows you where the adjacent or nearest, hydrants are. And also tells you how many people live in the house and what their ages are, and if there are children, their ages. It also tells you if there is someone in the house who is disabled and is in a wheelchair. So it gives a whole lot of information about the area that where the call originated. So anyway, I just want you to know that it's gone to another level now, and it's taking on a life of its own. And I think now, more than before, we know that we're going to have an end stage very soon. We also had an update today from Andrew Gottlieb on the wastewater and where we are with that. I think you know that both Andrew and Paul have been meeting with boards of selectmen and with citizens in all the various towns. I was at the meeting last Saturday in Falmouth, because that's where I live. And I can tell you that all the believers were there. I mean, all the people who really believe in wastewater solutions, and particularly in the use of alternatives as opposed to big pipes. And contrary to some public opinion, you may remember that in the recommendations from the Special Commission regarding wastewater, There was a statement in there that the county could consider creating a taxing authority with legislative approval and have a big pipe solution. And that was suggested or was recommended. I think Rob O'Leary sat here and told you about it and why he recommended it, because he wanted to put a stake in the ground to let people know that this is a serious problem and towns have to take it seriously and do something about their wastewater plants. But that is now completely off the table. And it is not going to be considered by the commissioners at all as part of any of the solutions that will come forward as this process begins to move forward. I think that's all I have.
Okay, are there any questions for Commissioner Flynn? Yes, Cheryl.
Thank you. Mayor Pat, my question has to do with the original wording of the motion that tasked Andy and Paul to examine the special commission's recommendations and come up with, I forget what the wording was, but come up with, you know, an assessment of how it could go forward. So I guess what you're telling us today about the taxing authority aspect of it is not a surprise, because we had started to hear that. But my question is, are you actually going to go back and revise that task that you gave to Andy and Paul to memorialize what you just said?
Well, as I recall, the language of the vote we took was to, we directed Paul Nitzwicki and Andrew Gottlieb, Cape Cod Commission and the Cape Cod Water Protection Collaborative, to look at any and all possible regional solutions to wastewater on a Capewide basis and complete that and make it available to the commissioners by December of this year. And we also asked them to consider public input. And what we did modify, well, we didn't modify it, but we clarified the fact that public input should come before they make the recommendations to the commissioners. In other words, don't make the recommendations to us, then we have to go out and do the public input. I think they've probably met now with all the boards of selectmen and probably had their conversations. If not, there's very few towns left. But then when they come up with a proposed set of recommendations, they're going to take that back out again into the community, not town by town, but probably Upper Cape, Mid Cape, Lower Cape, and maybe other places in between. So what we ask them to do is come back to us with recommendations for regional solutions. And it wasn't specific at all as to what those solutions would be. But I'll review that just to make sure. And if it wasn't that, and if it had in any way, I don't recall that it included anything about big pipes or sewering. But if it did, we'll review it at our next meeting and make sure it gets clarified.
Short follow-up? Well, it's short.
Okay, but it's directed towards the comments. The word entity came through on your press release in that motion.
Mm-hmm.
And I think what would be helpful, so that we're all on the same page, is if the phrase, if the entity which would have had taxing authority is off the table, then a new motion from the county commissioners would be helpful.
Thank you for that.
Anybody else?
I have some.
Yes.
Following along on those lines with the, they were born after Falmouth Saturday, and there's only six people there. I would hope that they would, when they have these meetings, that they have them at a time that's convenient for the public. Saturday afternoons in the summer is not very convenient for the public to go out and say what they feel about this wastewater problem that we have on the Cape. So that would be my suggestion, is to have it sometime when people can actually attend.
Thank you.
Yeah, Mary Pat, just because it's on my mind, we went through this in Chatham, and I see that they're going through it in Orleans now, and Falmouth, with wastewater recommendations on wastewater treatment. And parallel to what happened to us is that people are empowered to make recommendations, and then if the recommendations don't sit well with the segment of the public, they get hit with charges of bias or conflict of interest. In other words, it's a, unfortunately, people don't come up and they say, we don't agree. They say, well, we don't think you should be making the decision. For instance, already it's been suggested, I mean, that the county officials are all big pipe people and so on. The thing is that I would hope, I mean, this isn't aimed at you, but just from my personal experience, I would hope that the county commissioners and the people in the assembly, having empowered both Paul and Andrew to do this, that they would get the support of the commission and the people, send them out there, because inevitably they're going to be accused of being biased. I mean, already in Orleans, they've accused, they've spent $150,000 on a study to study alternatives. As soon as it came out, the people didn't like it. They said that the big pipe solution was more cost effective, and immediately the citizens who didn't agree with that came out and said, well, those people shouldn't be making the decision. They're biased. We want an independent jury. So, in other words, I think we should be ready to say, no matter what comes out of this, there's going to be somebody who's going to jump up and say that the people who are making the decision is biased. And I hope that you would stand behind it. That's all.
Who are you referring to when you say people? That people who are making the decisions are biased. Which people?
No,
the people in the town?
No, I'm saying that whoever, now let's say Andrew and Paul came up with a recommendation, not only will people disagree with that recommendation, but they're going to attack their standing. In other words, they're going to say, these people are biased, they shouldn't be making, we want an independent group, which usually means somebody who agrees with them. So, I mean, this is my personal rant, because I've been through this. But,
yeah. Yeah, well, you know, I think there probably will be, the recommendations, I would expect that the recommendations would be very broad, very general, because they won't apply to everybody. They won't apply to every town. I mean, I think, too, when you have public forums like that, they have to be very well constructed and very well planned. I mean, I'm used to public forums, whether they're on wastewater or whether they're on wind turbines, or no matter what they're on, that when you have, the meetings have to be extremely well planned, the agendas have to be very well planned, the public comment, and they're best done by facilitators who are experienced in having public forums. So they know what they're looking for, that every word that is said is recorded, and there are minutes, exact minutes, that like stenographers that actually take word for word what people say, because this is a really important issue for the Cape, and how these forums get planned will be key to the success of the information that we get back. So it isn't just Andy and Paul going out and having a conversation, which is what some of the meetings that Paul has been doing now have been. I was there for the one on Saturday, and it was a conversation because it was intended to be a conversation. And that's what it was, because you knew you weren't going to get a whole lot of people. I think there were maybe 12 in Falmouth. And they were people who really care about wastewater and have a stake in solutions, particularly alternative solutions other than pipes. So I think any kind of a public forum, that being what it is, has to be very, very well planned.
Marcia, yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I think on your June 27th meeting, and I don't know if you did it today too, you just discussed the recommendation of the Special Commission. I'm basing my request, my question on the article that was in the Patriot last Friday, on the comments that were made. So I guess I'd like an update of what you have discussed and regarding those different recommendations on the Special Commission. I don't, unless you want me to read.
No, I read that. Yeah,
I'm sure
I can't remember everything now that was in it, because we have not continued that discussion yet on governance within the last two meetings, and we won't, because we're working on other things right now, and people are on vacation, so we probably won't take it up again until August. But we are very much aware of what was in the article, and I'm sure we will address some of the aspects of it. Particularly the part about our agendas. I always think there's room to create much better agendas that are much more informed. And even the open meeting law has certain requirements that I'm not so sure that we absolutely always comply to the letter, but I think we can do a better job with our agendas.
This article didn't discuss the agenda, that's not what this article is on. This is the one that you were talking on the June 27th meeting.
Oh, about the Assembly of Delegates.
Right.
That's the one.
Right, that you have chosen, that you don't think it's the structure, it's you think it's us as members.
Well, I read that was a quote of a member of the commissioner made that statement. I will let that commissioner respond to his statement. I don't want to speak for that individual, thank you.
John, do you have a question?
Well, Mr. Speaker, I would like the other commissioner to defend his comments, because I'm very curious as to how they came about.
And a cheerful good afternoon to one and all. Welcome, Patrick. I was using what I would call a sports analogy. And the sports analogy had to do with if you were examining a structure, a team, if you will, and you are talking about suggesting improvements in how the team could be successful or not, the team is still in the league. So if you were to make any structural changes with regard to the numbers of the team, you're putting them at a disadvantage in terms of their ability to compete. So therefore, what's the other thing you look at? Well, you look at the management, or you look at the member. How do you look at the individual members of the team to see whether or not there's a there's an opinion? I'm saying that there's an opinion that you would pursue in a open and candid discussion as to what is the level of contribution or not among the members. But the first part was preceded by, you know, by discussion of where, if we're having a discussion that looks at all of the issues that are involved, why would you not want to talk about who was on the team? And if we're talking about the Red Sox, you can say, well, we needed, perhaps the center fielder could be better, or the second baseman, you know, could be a little bit better. But that was all part of the discussion. I don't apologize for it, and I wrote a letter to the editor, essentially defending the part where I said that it was a sports analogy and that it was all part of a general discussion. And in that letter, I gave an example, because we didn't discuss how I would define a high contributing member. In that letter, it occurred to me that I could use an example of someone that I have served with on the assembly, and someone I have observed over time. And I took that occasion to cite Julie Taylor as someone that I would suggest to you that, based upon the contribution that, in my opinion, that she's made, based upon the fact that I served with her for 4 years as she was my speaker at that time, that she has exhibited the kind of characteristics that I think that are in the higher standard with regard to, if I were identifying what an ideal definition would be, that's what it would be. But we didn't get to that part of the discussion, did we? We just got to the part where we were talking about members of the team. We're talking about if we're having a free-ranging discussion about how the team should be composed or reduced. I know they have penalty periods in hockey, and during that time you might have a shot and a goal. But again, when I had been asked with regard to my opinion about the assembly, even though we've had our differences over the years, I've always felt that it's difficult for me to accept the idea that you improve the quality of representation by reducing the number of representatives, especially since the most important constituent that I report to continues to remind me that I like the idea of having a representative of my own, even though it's Leo. You know. So that's all part of, let's say what I'd call a discussion. Now, I hope, and I see a few smiles back here, I hope that you understand, let's say, the point from which I, began the discussion on there. And by the way, you're all welcome to come and, you all come and join us and be part of that discussion, because I think that's all part of, what that kind of a discussion is. And at some point, I think that we have some responsibility to turn over the, our recommendations and send them over here for, for further discussions. I'm glad that you paid attention and saw that, because it means that there's interest beyond the discussion over there to see where we're going with this. So,
John, did you?
Let me lead it off. I found no sports analogy in anything I read in this article, and I've been a sports fan for more than 50 years. Let me quote, "I believe it's a question of the members of the assembly as opposed to the structure of the assembly." In other words, you really basically said that we weren't doing our job, what I read, with no sports analogy whatsoever. And I'd just like to know who you were talking about. I'm somewhat offended.
John, we've been friends, and you certainly would not be included in any, of any accusation with regard to it. But that's the kind of provocative question that I don't think I'm going to answer. You know who you are.
Just before we move on, to what would amount to official county business and get off this topic, are there any more questions on this? Okay. Thank you. I'm holding it. I forget. Now we move on to communications from Cape Cod Cooperative Extension Director Bill Clark regarding the Agricultural Research Corporation. I hope the commission will stay around in case we have some questions for them.
Before I begin on the ARC, two things. One,
identify yourself first.
Bill Clark, Director of Cape Cod Cooperative Extension. Thank you. Before I begin on the ARC, two things if I could. One is the annual tour of extension projects, which we do, usually in August, is going to be happening on August 8th. We hope as many assembly members can join us as possible. We typically load the bus. We will load the bus here at 9 o'clock on August 8th. And with the tour this year will be in Dennis, Howich, and one project so far in Chatham. So what we try to do is showcase projects we're doing in the communities. And we, as you, those of you that have been on it in the past, we moved the tour around different parts of the Cape. Last year we went from Eastham to Provincetown. So every year we go somewhere different. So that's the event this year, August 8th. We'll leave about 9, and I'll try to get you back, 2:30, 3 o'clock. It does take up a whole day for you, but we'll make it worthwhile. Okay? Item 2 on my list is my equipment malfunction story. I had a PowerPoint to show you, and it, across the parking lot it worked, and as I came across here, it's not working. So I'm glad I made copies of the PowerPoint for you. So you'll hear me talking as opposed to the PowerPoint, so my apologies. I'm sort of a technology dinosaur, but at least I had it working within the last 12 hours, so somehow it's not working. All right, so I just wanted to inform you of a regional project that I've been working on for a couple of years, and hopefully recruit your support for this project. So that's my objective today. First of all, for those of you that are not familiar with Aquaculture Research Corporation, it's in the town of Dennis. It's the only commercial shellfish hatchery in Massachusetts. One of the three owners is here, Gail Hart. is here. And several years ago, I guess probably three or four now, the owners came to me, as our department works closely with ARC on shellfish projects, and came to me and expressed concern that they're looking forward to retirement sometime in the future. Also, the hatchery is in need of repairs. They were not in a position to take large loans out at this point in their career to move forward with a new hatchery, and asked me if we could work together recruiting grants and maybe the county's interest in obtaining this regional hatchery. So with that, I've been looking for support through federal and state agencies for the last couple of years, most recently working quite a bit with Seth at Senator Wolf's office. Well, Seth is here, and Representative Turner, Representative Peak. Just to give you the list, Lieutenant Murray has been to the site, Secretary Sullivan, EOEA, has been to the site. I'm leaving people out. When I was in Truro last 2 weeks ago, Governor Patrick was there, and I was able to get his ear for 5 minutes and explain the importance of this hatchery. Unfortunately, we haven't received any funds yet. I'm still working on that. What I wanted to do is give you an idea, a background on why this project's important. In my opinion, it's the ultimate economy and environment project. That's all you hear about when you hear about the Cape. You hear about the importance of how economics and environment work together. In my opinion, this is the ultimate in that case. ARC, as I said earlier, is the only commercial shellfish hatchery in Massachusetts. And actually, I believe they were the first hatchery in the United States to actually spawn seed. All of the commercial growers, harvesters, on the Cape, get their seed at one point from ARC. So the way it works is the county goes out to bid through my department. We find out what every town needs for seed for both the recreational fishery and the commercial fishery. Those seed are obtained, and we go out to bid. In the last couple of years, ARC was the only bidder. In the past, we did have a bid from New York Hatchery and one from Maine. They're very small by comparison. And as an aside, in both cases, they couldn't deliver when it came to the due date. So we had to actually go back and rely on ARC. So all the seed that is sowed and ultimately reaped by the commercial fisheries came from ARC. On average, we have about 1,400 commercial diggers on the Cape. I think this year we have last year we had about 1,254 licenses. But I took the average of the last 10 years, there were 1,454. Those are jobs. Those are jobs that people are out harvesting clams, oysters, whatever, scallops. And without the seed that was sown, those would not be harvested. There's 235 shellfish farms on the Cape, aquacultures. About 90% of them get their seed from ARC. So without ARC, those families that depend on their farm, their seed from their farm would not have it without ARC. So you can see the importance. They employ about 20 people year-round, so they're also an employer. So we went to work looking for grants, and unfortunately to this date, I have nothing to report to you, in spite of all our efforts. Recently had this idea where maybe we could consider a user fee. Some people translate that into a tax, but if you know me, I'm pretty conservative, and it's a user fee. In my town, if I play golf, I pay for the golf course. If I don't play golf, I don't pay for the golf course. It's all self-funded by user fees. That's the analogy I'm using here. The average number of recreational licenses that were sold on the Cape over the last 10 years was 16,200. The average number of commercial licenses was over 1,400. My idea is to assess a $10 user fee for every recreational license that's sold. For every commercial license that's sold, there'd be a $50 user fee. The towns would collect this money above their own license. That money would be sent to the county, to our finance department, and be used to pay back a loan. Based on my numbers, The money we'd collect, we could borrow $3.2 million, pay back over 20 years. I used the 4% number just, it's a conservative number, just to run the calculations. The purchase price is $4 million, or $800 short. I then will be looking, continue to look for grants and be visiting the town CPC committees to see if they'd be interested in contributing to this regional project. So that's what we're doing. I wanted, again, to let you know what we're doing. You have my slides. There's pictures of the place. Actually, the first visit on August 8th on our tour is ARC. So if you want to see it, it's 39.7 acres on a barrier beach called Chapin Beach, for those of you that are not from the Mid-Cape area. That alone is worth preserving. It has a salt marsh right adjacent to it. It's alive with birds and other wildlife. But as importantly, it has this hatchery that is the sole source for seed. So that's the pitch. Happy to answer questions. I'm not sure through your protocol whether the others can speak here. I know Gail's here, and the county commissioners have been very supportive of this effort. We had it appraised. And that's where we got that number. We had it appraised actually 3 years ago, and then most recently last year, because of the market, I wanted to make sure the numbers were accurate. Actually, the appraisal was, they said that the best use of this property would be for a kingdom home, and maybe one a guest house on the property, using the existing footprint. I hope I don't wake up some morning and see a kingdom home being built out there. So that's why I'm here. That's why I'm making the rounds to your shellfish committees, your selectmen, and I hope that if you're interested, I can recruit you to be there when I come to your town. So far, the Brewster selectmen have voted to endorse the idea of this user fee concept. If we get, if it goes forward, the Chatham Shellfish Advisory Committee has agreed to promote this with their selectmen, and I'm on the agenda for at least 7 or 8 other towns in the next month or so. As you know, any regional project, it sounds good, but it's not easy. There's at least 15 opinions out there when you're working with these regional projects. I think Mr. Doherty has something to say.
You said what I wanted you to say, which is we're asking them for help to get recruit interest in the community that they represent.
Yes. And I didn't invite any the shellfish community here to stack the deck on you. I wanted to have a conversation should you want to have a conversation, or I gave you a fact sheet through Janice. I hope you all have that fact sheet on all the details, the project benefits. I would be happy to supply you with anything else. The owners have been very gracious about providing tours to everybody that I've been bringing out there, and I'm sure that would continue. So that's what we're working on.
Now, Julian? We'll take questions from the committee.
Sure.
Anybody else wants to respond?
If we don't do this, is there any place to get shellfish seed?
There's only, to my knowledge, there's only two other hatcheries that are in business currently. Fisher's Island in New York is a small hatchery, and Muscongus Bay in Maine is a small hatchery.
Now, not small, as big as this?
No, and they're not able to supply the seed that's needed for the municipalities and the in the private shellfish grants. Now, ASR also supplies seed to communities off Cape and also to Rhode Island, so they're exporting seed as well. Now, one other concern that the shellfish community, if I can speak for them, is when seed comes from out of state, it's not local, it's not native, it doesn't maybe have the hardiness, or may have other disease issues that otherwise may not exist.
Could I ask one?
Yeah.
Is there any way, if we, you're talking about the county owning it.
This is, yes, the plan.
And the county operating it.
No, this is the plan. I'm sorry, I'm glad you brought that up. That was part of my presentation, but it's somehow in technology space here. The plan would be that the county purchased this property, owns it, maintains it in perpetuity, so we have a hatchery. My opinion is that the county shouldn't be in the seed business, we shouldn't be in farming business either, or any business similar to that, we would lease it to a grower or to growers that are familiar with this. We've been working with the owners on developing a purchase and sale agreement, and part of the purchase and sale would be that we would purchase it, lease it back to the current owners if they rebuild the hatchery at their own expense, and they would get a term of about 20 years. That's unofficial because nothing's been signed on yet. Both the owners, their lawyer and the county council, and Mark Zelinski and I met with them on Friday, and we still have a little ways to go on that, but that's the thinking at this point, that we would own it and retain. Once this group is interested in not farming anymore, raising seed anymore, we would retain another group to perform this function. And as I said, it's 1,400 plus jobs. I would say that's conservative. If you include the agriculturists, we're in excess of 1,500 jobs. What's frustrating for me is if this was Raytheon or Genzyme, the politicians would be falling over themselves to help them out. We're talking about individual family farmers here and fishermen who don't get the recognition they deserve. It's all part of the way of life here. It's a native historic industry. And if I could add, I was talking to one of the wholesalers down in Wellfleet the other day. This is just one wholesaler. They're doing 4,000 oysters a day, just oysters. So they're selling 4,000 a day. Their hope is at some point they'll be selling 10 million oysters in a year. Now when you think about that, that goes to restaurants, fish markets and all. In the restaurants we have waiters, waitresses, kitchen help, truck drivers. So I'm very conservative when I talk about the jobs here and how this is part of the fabric of the Cape. People think about the Cape as the seafood industry.
Okay, Teresa, do you have something to say?
Yeah, I just actually have two things. First, what I was hearing you say, this sounds like it's very analogous to the county farm. This is already sort of a model for how this
Yes, there is. Yes.
I just want to make sure I understood that. And second, I just want to say that I think that we talk a lot about the economic mix of this region, and I think this is absolutely a critical component of it. I think it is a natural asset that the region has. It has never even begun to leverage in the way that it could. And I think this also makes a very strong statement that this is a sector that we can embrace and grow. And you look around the world at how different regions who have similar assets have grown aquaculture as an industry segment. And there's great potential. And I think we should be serious about that as an economic sector as well as the environmental components.
Just to add to the environmental component, when they did the TMDLs for the nitrogen loading, that included the existing shellfish populations that are out there. And several years ago, some of you were on the board and some are new, so we did a presentation on remediation of nitrogen using shellfish. We have several projects. Those of you that were on the tour a few years ago in New Orleans, we took you to a site where we're building oyster reefs to clean up the water there. And if you take the shellfish out of the equation, the TMDLs will go up. So it's as they, like us, they need nitrogen in their diet for proteins, and without it, they won't exist.
All right,
I'm sorry, that didn't come out right.
I'm the delegate from Truro, and I'm also on the Truro Conservation Commission. We very recently approved two new aquaculture projects up there, and in doing that and having our hearings on the notice of intent, I was very surprised at the public perception. I mean, I think that we have I heartily endorse these projects, but I think we have a public education issue here. We had a lot of people come in to complain about the project going in saying, well, it's going to make the water dirty. It's going to attract, you know, too many birds. Well, the public doesn't really, I think, understand that it cleans the water, it doesn't make it dirty, and that this is a traditional operation. This is a traditional means of making a living here on the Cape. It's one of the things that we took into consideration in approving these. But I have another question for you. This is really like from the depths of my own ignorance. It used to be that there were oysters like everywhere, right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, so how come we got to grow seeds for them now?
For years they were harvested and very little was sown. So if you reap, you gotta have to sow. If you want to reap, you have to sow first.
It's a question of
utilizing the resource. For years, Wellfleet, for example, has been in the oyster business for hundreds of years. And when you read Thoreau's book, Cape Cod, he talks about the oystermen in Wellfleet. It was so big, my dates might be wrong, but within the last 100 years, that they were bringing lots of seed up from the Chesapeake. Unfortunately, those oysters, even though they're the same species, they're a different variety, not as hardy, and there were diseases came with them. There are several diseases my department's working on, QPX, there's another one called JOD, there's a number of diseases that they have, so all the more reason they have local stock. So that sort of wiped out the area. And you know, to get a grant in Massachusetts, you have to go to a site that's not currently productive. It has to be deemed unproductive. And to the credit of the farmer, he makes it productive, or she makes it productive, so.
Well, we have not had a large population of oysters in Truro for a long time. I think that's the effort that's undergoing now, is to try to bring that back to a...
To your comment on water clarity, the oyster reef we developed at the mill pond in Orleans, we rely on neighborhood people to help maintain it, get the fouling off and so forth. One of the gentlemen that lives there was telling us that he swims every morning, and as he swims across the bay and he gets towards that oyster reef, the water clarity is much cleaner. And as he sees, as he gets the oyster reef, it's really clean. So it's a demonstration project for the people in town that don't believe it. We'll take them there if you'd like.
Well, we certainly support the work that you're doing here, and I hope that we can help you fund this project.
Just to give you some numbers, we're looking at, I was using the numbers just for what we could collect. The money we could collect, if every town is on board, and again, I used a 10-year average. There's currently over 17,000 recreational shellfish around the Cape. The average is 16.2. So as the fishery goes, there's some years where the numbers go up. Some years we had only 1,000 commercial diggers. In other years, back in 99 through 2004, we had over 1,600, some years over 1,800 diggers. So I'm using average numbers to come up with it. So there's years that we'll be short and other years that we'll have a surplus. But the number I used was just what we could afford, and that was 3.2. The 4 million, if we were to borrow it all, it would be 290,000 a year to pay it back. I think we can bring in 235,000 a year using user fees. And again, I haven't been to all the towns. I've talked to the constables. I've talked to shellfish committees. So I'm making the rounds, and I'm not here to tell you that we have all 15 towns on board. I have a lot of people that are interested, but as they said in Jerry Maguire's, you know, show me the money.
let me take a few more questions here, okay? Marcia.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I think this is great. I concur with Teresa and Deborah. This is a regional economic development. This is what Cape Cod is. In the sense of money, and I guess this is kind of directed more to the commissioners, this is where the EDC should be. EDC gets $400,000 a year. I know they've given money to the Cape Cod Commission, but they, I believe, have over $100,000 per year. This is what the EDC should be paying for. This is exactly what is going on. And I would highly recommend, and I will push for to take EDC money to assist in this. This is a fabulous project, and I would hope that we would all come together and assist them in supporting this. As you said, this is Cape Cod at its best. And first thing I thought, you're talking about a shortfall in the difference of money between the 4 million and 3.3. That's the EDC should be stepping in and making that grant, because everybody's paying for that out of their license plate money. Thank you.
It also would show good faith on the county's part that we have some skin in the game too.
Spiro, I'd like to see Marcia's EDC and raise it.
Thank you.
This industry is so vital to the local economy. It permeates to so many businesses and workers that it behooves us to preserve it, as Bill said, in perpetuity. It is easy to say, let's ask the EAC to do it, but I suspect that we'll be back here in 6 months' time looking at something in our own budget to help affect this project and have it come to fruition. And I, for one, wouldn't mind seeing this show up in the county budget because it affects everybody who's here, every county resident. I've been privileged to be able to look at this project from the other side of the town line, from the years I spent at Bass Hole kind of staring out at the ARC and wondering what it was, and now I'm equally privileged to be serving the business community in the town of Dennis where they're located, and discover exactly what it means in terms of economic impact to both that community and to the county. So I would wholeheartedly support your efforts, and please come back and ask for whatever you need to make it happen.
Just so you know what you're up against, if we go to the town together, your town together, or if you go on your own to speak to your local officials, a lot of towns have already recently increased their fees, and now they're looking at it another fee, and you can imagine what, how many eyes will be rolled when that comes up. But you know, the option is, and to the credit of the commercial harvesters in Chatham, they make their living on the waterfront, and they asked, I think I was there an hour and a half, and they were peppering me with questions. They realized that if this doesn't happen 3 years from now, there's not going to be a lot to harvest. So to their credit, they said, you know what, they'll go for it. So that's the pitch, and we've been working with ARC for owners for a few years. You know, it's their retirement, it's their whole life. One of the things we're talking about Friday in the PNS is giving us 6 months to more months to show some good faith effort on our part. That's why I'm out amongst the towns trying to get their support and looking for more grants. Senator Wolf and Seth have been very helpful in trying to coordinate meetings and find agencies within the state that might have funds. So anybody you know or that could help, I'm certainly willing to talk to them.
John, did you have something to say?
Thank you. Yeah, Bill and I have been talking about this for several years now, and I really wholeheartedly agree that we need to do this. I guess just to follow up on what you were just saying, is there any hope, is there any particular direction that we can talk to the state about some specific grants that might push this forward?
Well, I guess I'll defer to Seth on that one, but the ones we've looked at so far, for example, land acquisition, as I said earlier, is a perfect opportunity for land acquisition. But we're trying to run a business here. So we haven't found anything that allows for buying a business on really important land, real estate. When we did the appraisal, we separated 29 acres of the 39 out. So I asked the appraiser to do a price on 29 and then a separate price on 10 plus the hatchery, so that in the event that there's land money alone, we could separate it. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, through that 29, the way it's set up, is the driveway and the road structure, so that kind of reduces the value from a wildlife perspective in some people's minds. So I guess that's a long answer to your question. No, we haven't found anything yet, and we're still looking. We've talked to federal EDA people. There was even money awarded for the Buzzard Bay oil spill, knowing that they were trying to restore their fishery in Buzzard Bay. Was looking for them for funds, and that didn't work out. So we've been looking, and I've been working with our grant writers here in the county to find opportunities.
Cheryl?
Thank you. Not to do your job for you, but when you mentioned about buying land to run a business, it seems a little more like what you're doing is similar to what we do when we buy land to drop wells for water.
Mm, true, yes.
So it's not precedent setting.
That's
so
true.
So that was one thought. The second one was very similar to what the delegate from Truro was talking about in terms of natural propagation versus us coming in and seeding it. I didn't realize when I first got involved in town government that my town was buying seed. I had no concept of that. I thought it was like in the old days when you went out there with the clams and you picked them up. So then I started understanding that this was going on, and I started wondering what we were doing within this program to reseed it. Is there any obligation or is there any activity going on to measure what we're pulling out relative to the seed so that we're starting to build up a base? And if there, if
yes,
there isn't, you know, whose obligation? Is it a county or town?
We have, I'm not sure if I did it this year, but in past budget seasons of, in my budget, I have $30,000 in there for buying seed for municipalities. It just passed through my budget. We go out to bid. This year, we spent $38,000. The argument that I usually bring with me to that subcommittee is a scenario of the number of seed we buy, and I give you a scenario on if 75% survive, 50% survive, 25% survive. So I give you that whole thing. I don't have it with me, and I don't even have my glasses with me, so I couldn't find it if I had it. So, but I do have those numbers, and I know if you talk to your Tony and your warden, he can vouch for the fact that what they're seeding is what is being harvested by both commercial and recreational.
Right, but my question was more about, is there some obligation to harvest a little bit less than what we're seeding so that we start having a natural base again?
That's part of fisheries management. That would be town by town. Although, one of the big pluses to the aquaculture businesses is they have farms on municipal property that they're raising oysters and coax for the most part. They spawn, and that spawn is in the water column, and in the town fishery benefits from that spawn. So, Wellfleet, there's probably 100 of those farms, and they have the most, but every town, and now for Old Provincetown, I was at that meeting when we were trying to establish that aquaculture zone last winter, and it looks like it's very promising. But the success of those potential businesses is whether they can get seed. I've had growers from Wellfleet, or growers from Orleans come to me saying, you know, one guy in Wellfleet just said, I just hired two people. If we don't get seed, there's three of us out of a job. So that's simple.
Bill, can I get some more questions?
Absolutely, here? Sorry.
Okay. Leo, our aquaculture, our head of the Cape and Islands Farm Bureau.
Hey, with the fear of being labeled a team player, I'll let you know that I too am concerned with this property and I would like to see us move forward in some fashion. You mentioned and have been talking about us purchasing the property and then in turn releasing it to a farmer. I'm going to use the term farmer because aquaculturalists are farmers.
That's correct.
Have you looked into the purchase of an agricultural preservation restriction on the property so that a individual can actually own the property and have a vested interest in the buildings and the land so that they will be able to, when they go to retire, reap some benefit to that? And I say this to you, Bill, from two points.
Well, the answer to your question is yes.
Okay, you have.
When we started talking, I don't know, I've lost track now, 3-4 years ago, the first meeting I had was with the Commissioner of Agriculture. And at the time, he was Scott Soares, the former aquaculture specialist. And that whole program is based on soil as a resource. Now, this is a sand dune. The APR committee does not even understand aquaculture, never mind look at their soil as a resource. We were trying to convince them otherwise. And the other issue is, the most they pay is usually around $2,500 an acre. And waterfront property goes for a lot more than $2,500 an acre. Yeah. So that was another problem. But we have a new commissioner on July 30th at 10 o'clock. The commissioner and I will be visiting with the owners to revisit that topic to see if we can make some exceptions.
I just want to tell you, don't put a lot of weight into the APR program, either by the state of Massachusetts or the federal program. My kind of direction or suggestion would be that the county be the holders of the agricultural preservation restriction. And instead of the county coming up with $4 million, and I'm just going to use rough numbers just to get my point across, instead of the county coming up with $4 million to purchase the property and then leasing it to Leo for $1,000 a year because I have to put in all these improvements, and I'm only going to have a 20-year lease on the property. So 20 years from now, when I retire, I really don't have anything to give to my daughter. It would seem to be just an area that I would like you to look into, that the county put up $3 million, and Leo puts up $1 million. Now I own the property. I will want to invest in the property. I will want to make it a going business. Because in 20 years, when I want to retire, and I want to give something to my daughter, I can subsequently sell it to someone else. It's not going to be for $6 million because it's going to have a agricultural preservation restriction on it held by the county, which only allows me to do one thing there, grow seed. But I will be able to certainly recoup my million. Maybe if I'm lucky and the market goes up a little bit, I might even be able to get $1.5 million out of it. I tell you that from a personal standpoint as a farmer, because not only do I own my own farmland, I also lease farmland from municipality. And when I tried to make that pitch to the municipality, the narrow-mindedness of some of those people in charge thought it was better for them to purchase it, and I argued that I didn't think it was, because again, now I'm paying a pretty reduced rate for a large amount of land, but again, I only have 10 more years left in my lease, and at the end of that lease, I have no equity. I would have much rather had done a purchase agreement with the town where they held the agricultural preservation restriction, and I had equity in this land.
Sure.
It's just a thought, and again, please don't hang your hat on the APR programs at the state, because I'm telling you from my experience, that's either dried up or has a lot more narrow-minded team players than we do here on the Cape Cod.
Bill, can I ask you a couple questions?
Sure.
There are two issues here, you see, is what the benefits are going to be to the Cape, to Barnstable County. And I know that you've spoken generally of the benefits, but normally what happens is something like this is you kick in a few dollars, $10,000, and you go to somebody who's in the business of making these assessments, and they come back to you in a month or 2 months and they say, we have looked at the economic impact of this business to Cape Cod, and it is X millions of dollars. So it's just, rather than have us as the pitchmen going out and saying, well, it's a great idea, that we have something actually concrete. I don't know if I think the EDC would be perfect to give that kind of money, but something do a study and say, look, it's not just us telling you this. You know, it's this. We looked and we documented. This is the economic benefit of Cape Cod of the shellfish industry. The other thing is that I've learned from personal experience is that, you know, 10-15 years ago, the fishermen in Chatham, and eventually throughout most of the outer Cape, were having problems, and they got together and they formed the Cape Cod Hook Fishermen's Association, which essentially is a lobbying group. I mean, that's what they do. Mm-hmm. Seth is very familiar with it. And they became very instrumental in getting funding and regulations and promoting the interests of the fishermen on Cape Cod. Unfortunately, the shell fishermen have not done that. In other words, they're not as cohesive a group, but if they are going to benefit from the existence of this hatchery, They're going to have to step up in places. I mean, Chatham. I know Chatham very well. I'm a former chairman of their shellfish advisory committee. I know Wellfleet would be very supportive. I mean, they have a direct financial interest. Barnstable, very direct financial interest. Falmouth, Bourne. You know, you get to other towns like Sandwich, for instance. They may not have as much of an interest, but if you go through the permitting process by increasing the fees, they're not going to kick in that much money because they probably haven't got as many licenses as, let's say, Chatham.
That's correct.
I was looking at some guys today bringing in some clams. I have kind of a clam boom there in Chatham. And there are some guys who've been doing it for years, not me. I kind of like to do clams, do colons. But, and they would bring in 400 pounds, 400, one guy. And I don't know what the price is, it's over a buck and a half. So they will complain if you raise their fee, $50, but don't listen to them. In other words, I don't listen to them. Just don't listen to them. There's more. It's well worth it in the long run for the commercial diggers to support this industry, which is another industry. But I'm more concerned as how we get from here to there, what the time frame is. I know you've gone to the towns and so on. The boards of selectmen are the ones that raise the fees. Do you have an end game here? Do you have some kind of a time frame in which you can get a commitment on the part of the boards of selectmen to increase those fees if that's the way you're going to go? Or?
In the perfect world, they would approve it and have it in their fiscal 14.
Yeah.
So, I again, all 15 downs have different times that they set fees. Assuming that many set them before January 1st, I would hope that they'd be willing to do this and set their fee with this user fee for January 1st. Some towns are kind of wondering, gee, what are the other towns doing? So, it's kind of chicken and egg, but as we build up some inertia here, we'll...
Well, I know Chatham, the fee setting process doesn't go through town meeting. I mean, it's the boards of selectmen who set the
right,
fees.
That's correct.
And that's how it works. I mean, I think this is a good idea. I personally deal with ARC and have for a number of years, and I know there are benefits that they do other things besides seed and so on. But from an environmental standpoint, I mean, that's basically beach property. I'm amazed that no one, the town of Dennis or somebody, hasn't stepped forward to say we want to preserve this property. I mean, they're going to put up a wind turbine and everybody's yelling and screaming. But yet here's an example of them stepping in to preserve the property, regardless of the hatchery, to simply preserve the property in the public domain, and no one seems to be pushing the issue. I know you have, but I'm surprised they haven't. But I'd like to see this go to the next level. You seem to have the support of the assembly. If we could give it a structure to which we say, okay, we're aiming to, I know you're still in negotiations with the ARC, but as from our standpoint, you have a concrete proposal, you can put it out there in a sense, rather than go to, you know, here, there, and everything, this is the proposal, we can publicize it, we can ask the people, and I know they're organized in Wellfleet, I know the Barnstable has an active shellfish community, we can basically push the project that way.
Sure.
And that's what I'm looking at. Leo?
You know, I listened to everybody around the table, and we all seem to be in favor of this, and you know, I'm prepared, if it's appropriate, and my colleagues would accept it, just to make a motion, very vague motion, that the Assembly support the efforts of Bill Clark and the County Extension Service Office in pursuit of the regional plan to purchase the OCC property, and also that he continue to research creative financing plans and applying for grants for this purpose.
You got that in writing?
Yes, I do.
Okay, why don't you submit it to the clerk, just so we know what we're talking about. And so that's a motion on the table. So I have, before we can go any further discussion, I need a second. Okay, second.
Under discussion purposes, Mr. Speaker, it's very vague, it's very simple. I just want Bill to leave here being able to, when he goes to these towns, saying that he made a brief presentation to us and that we are in favor for him to continue to pursue this idea. Doesn't put us on the hook for anything. We're not signing any purchase and sales agreements. We're just giving him a little pat on the back saying, you know what, we need to further research this. So I hope everybody will vote in favor of it.
Okay. Yes, Teresa.
I just want to note that in the materials that Bill has provided, it looks like the USDA says it's a $10.8 million industry.
Yes. When you were asking about economic numbers, you'll find depends on what agency you talk to, you'll get a different number. So unfortunately, there's nobody compiling their data that I've found. So, and it's also farm gate numbers. So I think the economic, the real number should be multiplied times 4 to give you the real number.
So in light of that, I think Leo's idea is an excellent one. It's definitely something we should support.
Okay, Cheryl?
At the risk of, someone will be looking at it from this perspective, I'm just looking at the way this is posted, and it doesn't look like it's a discussion with the Assembly and a potential vote on a policy. It just says communication from.
You're overruled.
That's fine. But if this motion goes forward, you know, another way to deal with it is just put it on the next agenda as a policy, you know, discussion, so the public understands that we were debating something and going to vote on it.
For the record, we did in fact ask the AG's office for a ruling on that specifically, and they gave us a ruling in writing that stated that we did not necessarily have to have written in the agenda that a motion or action was going to be taken or not. Just the fact that the item itself was on the agenda was enough to warn them that a possible action could have been taken. So I feel very, very, in okay grounds if we go ahead and approve this.
Do we have a copy of that?
Everyone does.
Submit it to the clerk, yes.
Super.
Okay. There's no further comment. I will take the vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. Didn't give you any money, but that's the best.
Well, I thank you. It really means a lot. One of the owners is here, and I don't know if you, your procedure allows for public comment or not.
And yeah, before we convene, anybody can say anything to us.
I don't want to put Gail on the spot, but if you want to be on the spot, it's your time. Gail Hart is one of the three owners of the ARC, so.
Can't sell used car twice, man.
Gail Hart, Aquacultural Research Corporation. I'm officially the vice president, and my two partners, Richard Krause and Susan Meshi, are still back at work, working hard, and that's the only reason they aren't here with me this afternoon. But we really appreciate your taking an interest in this project. We've dedicated our lives to this company. We've all spent several decades there each, and we would really like to see this continue because we feel we have an obligation to all of the farmers we support and several generations of farm families in the shellfish industry here, as well as the commercial fishermen who benefit from all of the work that we do. We just don't want to see it just go away. That would be the easy way out, just sell the property and go away, but we've committed to not do that, and we're trying very hard, and we appreciate all the help that we're getting to see it go forward, and all of your suggestions, so thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Just I mentioned that Seth is here, and you all know Seth, but Sarah Peek and Claire Turner's aides are also here. I believe they're here in support of this, and so they'll want to give everybody an opportunity. They were nice enough to come. They wanted to say anything or just be acknowledged one way or the other.
Well, now with the assembly support, the circle is completed of support.
I've got more support than you. No, I really appreciate it. No. Okay.
Thank you very much.
All right, and if you don't mind, I'll try to remember to let you know when I'm coming to your town. So if you have that day or night free, you can come in and you'll know what's happening in these. Thanks.
We now move on to communications from public officials. Any public officials wish to speak? Communications from members of the public. Oh, we have a member of the public who would like to speak.
I'm Kathy Sherman. I did not intend to speak, but you'll notice I'm wearing the Booster Oyster t-shirt today. And what I wanted to say related to the ARC proposal is that some of us have been interested in the SPAT program. There's a SPAT program on Long Island at, I forget the name of the bay, but they use solar energy for the growing of the algae, and they also have sort of like a greenhouse for eel grass. And so in terms of agricultural product, it's not just seed that they're producing, but it's the way they use their cooperative extension. It's connected to Cornell, and it's an opportunity. There's mostly staffed by volunteers, and there can be community, sort of like a community garden, except shellfish, or there can be private homeowners. And it's partly, the rationale is partly that the water quality, but also the food. So I, in terms of like funding ideas and in terms of serving Cape Cod in a way, if part of this could be not just simply a lease back to an improved business, but sort of like the 4-H of marine life, I just thought that those might be somewhat crazy ideas, but worth adding on to it.
Any other members of the public wish to speak? Hearing none, the assembly now convene, the assembly will now convene, and we will begin with Standing Committee on Government Regulations and Recommendations on Proposed Ordinance 12-07, gravel mining. So, government rent is, that's right, I am. Okay, well, we have in your packet the report, which you should all received. And it was, I'm not going to go into the details, but it was approved, carried 4-0 to approve 12-07. It seems like 100 years ago.
It does.
Anyway, we have members from the commission here to speak. If any of you have any further questions on this, but I think we've thoroughly So I'm going to need a, I don't normally make motions from the chair, so I'm going to need one.
I'll make a motion we accept proposed ordinance 12.07, sand and gravel mining and cable pipelines, excuse me.
Okay, I have a second, it has been moved and seconded. Okay, any other further comments? If not, we will take a vote on this.
Mr. Speaker?
Yes.
Just for the benefit of anyone who might be listening in or watching in on television, anyone want to offer a quick synopsis of what we're voting on?
Okay, if you want. Pretty much explained it. I think I'm going to go through a whole thing, but this was part of the, the Cape Cod Commission Natural Resources began with a PowerPoint presentation. The presentation provided the committee with an introduction, process review, and overview of the proposed regulations. The RPP amendments are a response to the Ocean Act of 2008 for sand mining, cables, and pipelines in offshore waters that are open for development. The proposed regulations address a gap in protection in Cape Cod. The last 2 years were spent planning and developing regulations. You'll see from the minutes that they had questions existing local beach nourishment and basically the education of potential disputes related to the jurisdictional renourishment of public and private properties, as it says in this little page here. So, do you have a comment?
I read all of this. We had up in Truro some real interest in much smaller projects. And the only thing I would say is I think these are very good regulations. I would like to see the commission go a little further. Well, we've got people, everybody who owns a front loader would like to get down below the low water line and push something up on the beach. And we're standing with our dikes, our fingers in the dike, trying to keep, it causes erosion in other places when you do that change in topography, and I just would like to see this go a little further.
Yeah, that was subject that I brought up at the meeting about people looking to re-nourish their beaches, but the potential conflicts among private property owners, some want to do something, some want to do something. I was given the impression from the commission that's still going to be under local conservation regulations. It's still going to be, unfortunately, the sorry task of the town officials to try to educate that. John?
Also, the commission went to great lengths to identify exactly where sand mining could occur, especially, and it is very restrictive, so it wouldn't affect anything, I think, anywhere near the town of Truro, for one thing. It was very specific about certain areas within the bay.
Well, this is why I think they need to go a little further, because I think there is a lot of pressure out there for the kind of beach nourishment that you see going on in Florida, and I think that's going to become more of an issue as the water gets higher and the coast continues to erode. I mean, in Truro, all the big money is up along the bay, so that's where the pressure's coming from. I'm just simply encouraging them to go a little further than we have here, because local regulations are helpful, but I mean, look at that controversy that's going on right now at the Newburyport about those, whether they can do beach scraping to protect those houses. So.
We have a motion on table. It's been moved and seconded. We're going to take a vote on this.
Richard Anderson?
Yes.
Cheryl Andrews?
Yes.
Ronald Bergstrom?
Yes.
Leo Kukunis?
Yes.
James Killian?
Yes.
Marcia King?
Yes.
Teresa Martin?
Yes.
Deborah McCutcheon?
Yes.
Spiro Mitrokostas?
Yes.
John Omen?
Yes.
Paul Pilcher?
Yes.
Patrick Princey?
Yes.
Julia Taylor?
Yes.
Mr. Speaker, proposed ordinance 12-07 passes with 92.72% of the delegates voting yes, 7.28% are absent.
Okay, thank you.
No, I know what it is.
What we have are the two separate sections on it. One is a report from the standing committee on the ordinance, and the other is the actual vote of the ordinance.
Okay,
just taking the vote of the ordinance. I gave a spotty report on it. Now we have reports from committees. We have to do the minutes of the Special Commission of Inquiry on CBEC and CLC. Have the members had a chance to read the minutes from any additions or corrections on that?
I'll move the minutes as presented.
Okay, we have a second. We move and second. Any further comment? All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay, we now have a report from the clerk.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I just want to remind everyone that the AmeriCorps Year 13 graduation ceremony will take place Thursday, July 26th. I think you received notice to this effect earlier, a month or so ago, just reminding you.
Oh, by the way, I'm just going to jump in here. There was a news article this morning I think you should be aware of that the House of Representatives took a vote to defund the AmeriCorps program. So if any of you have any influence in Washington, it's been a valuable program for us, and I think we should press it too. Go ahead, I didn't mean to interrupt you.
That's fine. Also, just to let you know that we did receive approval to have the assembly meeting of August 15th at Nauset Beach. I was advised of that, and that was approved. As you recall, Mr. Clark reminded you about the county tour on August 8th, and I think I also sent you some information regarding how to contact him if, in fact, you want to attend that tour so he can reserve seating on the bus. And I also want to introduce, just briefly, Barbara Austin, who will act in my stead, hopefully, on August 1st, when I will, unfortunately, be absent from my first assembly meeting since I've been doing assembly meetings. And Barbara, you'll be in good hands with Barbara. And letting you know that. And that's it. That's all I have today.
Okay. Any other business to be brought before the committee? Leo.
Thank you. On June 30th, I had my annual farm open house, of which all you were invited to, and I'm here this evening to present a couple of awards. We had our first annual pig race held at that event, and this year was very unique because we actually had two winners. Deborah from Toro actually came in first place. She actually broke the record with her pig. It went down the chute at an astounding speed. But she incorporated the use of one of our cur dogs. And I don't know if any of you know what a cur dog is, but it's basically a herd dog for pigs. They're a cross between a pit bull and a bulldog. And she got one of those cur dogs to jump in the chute and chase the pig down the chute. And she won in record time. So we have a trophy for Deborah. Another first place winner and completely on the other end of the scale was Janice. Janice won our second heat, and ironically, by then the pigs were quite used to the chute, and she did not use one of the dogs. So basically what happened is they actually strolled down the chute, and she won first place having the longest time that it took from one end of the chute to the other. So we have two trophies for them. And since both first places went to the Assembly of Delegates, Cape Farm Supply thought it was appropriate that the Assembly get to hold the annual Pig Bowl. And hopefully next year we'll get some more people to participate, because this year the County Commissioners did not show up, and who knows, maybe next year they'll win the Pig Bowl if they come. But anyhow, thank you, and I'll make those presentations later. Thank you.
Okay. Any other business you brought before? Yes, John.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Speaker. I cordially invite you some to visit Liam's at Nauset Beach for a small get-together after the meeting on the 15th of seafood and our famous onion rings.
Okay.
I hope you will kindly all attend.
I have a little business. With the new member, Pat, I'm going to do some adjustments in the committee assignments, and I'll send them out after I talk to the people about the future. Very few minor changes, but we go from there. And I guess I will see you all August 1st, if that's it. I need one more piece of business.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Not to vote.
John, can we get my...
Yep.